Here to have you with us, and God, you've been a blessing to us, and you've God spoken to us and to me personally so many times. So glad to have you. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Wanted to ask and find out if I minister tonight because it will affect this morning. And so he said yes. So you're welcome back tonight. I love the presence of the Lord. And these are the days. And it's wonderful how the Lord will order your steps and direct your path. I was born in Franklin County. My birth certificate is from Franklin County. I don't know if you say it is there or whatever. James, just come on up here and put this, whatever you've got under this on. Okay. But I've been all over the world, and God will use whomsoever he chooses, and then whose he chooses those who choose him, to tell you the truth. And before the foundations of the world were laid, God had known us and he had determined who we are in Christ and what we are to do for his glory. I have been blessed to minister both to Terry McCollum and Phil Driscoll. I am a musician myself, so it's strong in me. Music is in my bones. And to carry that over, I watch and I wait to see where the Holy Ghost, where he's going to fall on which song that we sing and so forth, because that's where his presence is, manifested to the greatest degree. That does not mean that we shouldn't praise and worship him with the others, but it means there's one that will locate where he wants to set up, right there. And this morning, without a shadow of a doubt, I am convinced it was on the song, Holy, 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 Terry McCallum's song. And if you remember that song, there was not one reference to us. There was a reference only to our God. And I love Isaiah when he said, you know, God's speaking through him, that he looked and he saw no other gods. So we have gods because we make them gods. Amen. Which is the first person in our life, really, is what it boils down to. So God either is or he ain't, right? And I praise him for that. Phil Driscoll, my goodness, we ministered together many times. And he said he's the God above all gods. Well, I just don't even want to consider that there is a God. And I've heard that song and I've sang it and so forth and played it over and over and over. But this morning it hit me, maybe because it followed the one by Terry McCallum, Holy, Holy, Holy. And I think you need to be born again if you weren't touched on that song. Because these are the days. These are the days not just for him to move on our behalf again and to move on behalf of the earth or whatever, but these are the days when we are to get into that right position and place and even honor and blessing, a blessing our God, whose we are and whom we serve. Jesus came to this earth to do the will of the Father. He is doing his will on this earth through his body that will obey his will and obey the Father God's will. There's no doubt about it. I do have a magnificent message. In fact, more and more and more by the response, because I've ministered it for the first time on July the 21st in a great minister's conference. And I asked the Lord the moment I woke up that morning, still in the bed, what do you want me to minister to these people? Because others had ministered great messages, each and every one, and they continued to do so. And I heard a word that I've never heard before, and that word is lion-hearted. And I knew that God wanted me to minister. My part in the conference was to minister lion-hearted. When I was here one or two Sundays ago, I desired to impart that into you, the word and the message on lion-hearted. And so that's what I'm going to minister on this morning. I think I've ministered it once or twice before. I think one night only in Texas, and then I can't even remember if I ministered it another place. But it is a message that you cannot go out of here the same. But this is the time to get our attention off of ourselves and to get our attention on Almighty God. We become the person that we look at and like. You know, we become like them. And there's a psalm that says that Israel exchanged their glory for the ox thing. You know, I refuse to be an ox. It's what you look at is what you become. And if we keep looking at ourselves and trying to do this and trying to do that, we're going to more and more become like the old self that we don't want. Amen. It's time to turn away from all of that and to get our heart completely on the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And when we go to the Word of God, that's what we'll see. We see what we want to see. Amen. Revelation will be given to us as we expect it to be given to us. Father, we thank you that you've brought us together today. And Lord, it is a glorious time. As I heard, Lord, I've heard that series. I put that word on the first thing in the morning. And I heard this morning. It's a translation. And I heard the words, excellent glory. And it dawned on me. It just hit me like a ton of bricks, Lord. Went like a sword into my spirit. Excellent glory. You are excellent in glory. And you want to make us excellent in glory, Lord. And so we are the glory of Almighty God. We shine for you, Lord, and it is time to arise and shine. For our light has come, and darkness shall cover the earth and gross darkness the people. It's a promise. It's that which is going to come to pass, and it will be. But we can choose to be light, or we can choose to be darkness. And each and every one of us that are here this morning, Lord, choose the light. We choose the way, and we choose the truth. And I will speak in English, Lord. Thank you for it. Oh, thank you. We have ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to receive exactly what you want us to. These are the days, saith the Lord, when your ways are not my ways, and you're going to be walking in ways that you have never walked before. You're going to be walking in places, and you are going through an open door, because I set an open door before you, and you will come in, and you will learn of me, and you will be taught of me, and you will see that I will surely, surely, surely make thee into everything that I have called you to be. I desire to draw near to you. You want to please me. Well, if you want to please me, then call me and crawl upon my knee and become intimate with me. Expect me to be there. Expect me to look for everything that you want to be looking for, and know that I will shut a door that should not be opened in your life that concerns you, and I will close a door that you won't close. Amen. I will open a door that you can go through, and you can see that I have caused heaven to come unto you, and you have come unto heaven. Look unto me, and you shall be saved, my prophet Isaiah said. And I say unto you, all it takes is a look unto me, and you shall be saved. It shall be unto the uttermost experience in this life on the earth. So know this, I gave you a new birth that you could cover the earth by your prayers, by your your love and by your thoughts. For there is no distance to my spirit, saith the Lord. There are no boundaries to my spirit, saith the Lord. For I have called you and I have chosen you, and I intend to use you in great and mighty works you're going to do for my glory, saith the Lord. You are entering into a time of glory such as you have never experienced, such as you have never seen. You're going to go back to Pentecost, saith the Lord. You are going back to that time when the baptism and the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you in such a mighty way that you're going to be a demonstration of my works and what I want to say. So know this, that I have called you, I have chosen you, and that's enough for you. I remove the chains. Don't you put them back on, for I have made you free, saith the Lord. Give God the clap offering and glory. Woo, we thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Blessed be your name. Hallelujah. Oh, my. Ephesians chapter 4:23, just as an introduction here to sort of set the course for us, says, have the same attitude, mind, and motive as the Lord Jesus Christ. Ephesians 4:23, translations, mind, motive, attitude as Jesus. Before they ever invented the bracelets, I had read a book, and it was, the title of the book was, What Would Jesus Do? And it was a very affluent pastor and church, like the silk stocking church in a city. And that's just about what they got when they came to church, was nothing. Amen. And so something happened that turned that man into the very fire of Almighty God. And so what happened as a result of that, certain members of the congregation, the board members and all, they began to get it one by one, and it affected business, it affected home life, it affected everything in the city. What would Jesus do? If Jesus wouldn't do it, if Jesus wouldn't do it, let me say it three times, if Jesus wouldn't do it, we should not be doing it. Amen? That's a measuring board for us. Ephesians 5:1, some translations say, be an imitator of God. And the literal King James writes, be a follower of Almighty God. Okay, Jesus. Hebrews 13:8. I think about the first verse he ever gave me for ministry outside of the local city or the local church. And it was, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If we want to know what Jesus would do, we can read the four Gospels. And we can learn quickly what Jesus would do. Who can list all of his characteristics and his attributes? You can't do it. He is more than one mind can hold. He is everything that is good, right? The devil is everything that is evil. But Jesus is everything that is good. The one I want to magnify this day, I don't know, I'll have to get my eyes on the clock just a few minutes to see how long to go and then just cut it off and continue again tonight. But who can list his attributes or his characteristics? And that's what's happening to us. Each and every moment of every day, every choice that we make has to do, it affects us as to an attribute or characteristics or a character in our life. So it's not just a one-time choice. It's every moment of every day, in every situation, every thought, and every word. Yes, this is a time of change. This is not a time of change pointing at you, but the thumb pointing right back. We had a conference last week, and I am telling you, not one person went out of there the same, because God came in and he changed each and every one of us in the times of meetings that we had together. It brought change, saints. There's not one of us. I've been changing. I want to change. I'm more focused. I'm more sensitive to my own words and to my own thoughts, to my own ways. And when I see something then I know Jesus wouldn't do it that way. I don't even think like that. But I just know that one thing is not right. And I repent. And I've grown just in a week's time through that conference 10 days ago, maybe we should say, it started. Why do we want to magnify him? Because we want to lift him up. We want to glorify him, right? And we want to be assured, assure us and strengthen our confidence that we can and should be like the Lord Jesus Christ. I have found in my travels of almost 50 nations that when people like in Russia or the communistic nations, former communist, or like in Africa, but not so much there or India. You know, they have been preaching. Well, I'm not going to be negative. But anyway, let me just settle it with those that are in the communist bloc countries. When they make a decision for God, it's whole hog, as we would say in Georgia. It is all the way. It's nothing held back. And if they have to leave certain people, they just love them, but they leave them. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? They are going to follow Jesus one day, one step at a time. Amen. And then 1 John 4:17 says, as he is, so are we in this world. Listen, Jesus is not defeated. On the cross of Calvary, he won. We have won. But because Jesus Christ in us is the hope of glory. He is the victory within us. Yes, we need one another. We need prayer, like Moses and Ur. We need somebody holding up our arms at times, right? Osheta mahasita. We have a body, and we need each other, joint to joint, each joint supplying its part. Each and every one of us are at a different level. Each and every one of us are at a different place. Each and every one of us need to be touched by the Lord in a way that we need to be touched. And he needs to speak to us individually. And you know, that's a part of maturity. You stop trying to make everybody like yourself. Come on, you accept everybody and you see where they are. You see them through the eyes of the Father. And you don't beat them up, you know. I am a leader. And my personality is to want to change everything and make it like I think it's right. I confess that to you. But you know what? I've come to know and to love just people and their gifting or themselves. There's my grandfather Gunnels taught me, no matter how raunchy they may seem to be, there's something good in there. And no matter how poor the preacher is, there's something good in there that God can speak to us and can bless us and help us. Amen? But as he is, so are we in this world, sweet people. We're more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. All of the authority has been given unto him, but he said, I give you the authority. And I've got news for you. Satan may be after you, nipping at your heels or whatever, but God says, I shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. So begin to stomp your feet and to clap your hands and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. He has to go. Hallelujah. Another thing that you find out as you grow and you mature is you can't make anybody do anything. Whew, that was a hard lesson for me. But you can't do it. You've just got to live it. You've got to be the example. You've got to love them no matter. And they will, praise be unto the Lord. He is going to get a hold of them. You know why I'm sure of that? Because Job 22:30 in the Amplified says, I will save him, I'll deliver him who is not innocent because of your own prayers. Hallelujah. And I'm going to put on the Facebook soon, have them to put on there for me. I'm still computer illiterate, but I've got a staff. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I handwrite and they do. Amen. But I'm going to put on there scriptures to it that we should be praying and speaking over our children's. Can you shout amen? Over our children's generations, you know, and in that, blessing them. I know, like Vanessa, she doesn't need them. Praise God, she's got one that all of y'all bless. Can you shout amen? But not everybody lives that life. Amen? Moving right along now. Okay, turn to Revelation chapter 5. Okay, remember what we're on? Do y'all remember? Hallelujah. We're on the lion-hearted. Amen. Now this is, okay, he said, just read it and be quiet. And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" And no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much, because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders saith unto me, "Weep not. Behold, look and see. The Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof." Be imitators of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lion-hearted, you have a choice. I have a choice. There are many different kinds of hearts, heartedness in the Bible. But the one that is opposite the lion-hearted is faint-hearted. Faint-hearted. So when the Holy Spirit was ministering these things to me, then my next question, faint-hearted, you know, lion-hearted, but not to magnify that truth above being a lion-hearted. So we're going to get this real quickly, and we're going to see what it is, because he says don't be ignorant of Satan's devices and flesh, you know, and we're wanting to get rid of flesh. So I looked it up. And you think about it now and judge your own self. Examine yourself, because if it's locating you, if these are your characteristics, I've got good news. One change, and it's done. Amen. Hallelujah. And the word faint-hearted, faint means small-souled. Small-souled. S-O-U-L-E-D. Well, where is the will? Where is the mind? Where is the emotions? I think there are five down there. Or is that covering them all? You know? Small-minded. Do you know what that, just having a small mind? Brother David, when I moved back to Coa, Georgia in 1980 at God's direction, the Lord gave me these words. You will have to protect yourself, guard yourself against microscopic vision. What did he mean, microscopic vision? The overruling spirit there was to be little, to be microscopic, to think nothing big is going to happen. Listen, I have a number of wells about Stevens County, wells that need to be dug up. R.G. Letourneau, he may have built a home out there in Texas, Longview, but his home, too, was Tocoa, Georgia. And he built Letourneau's steel plant, right? That built the area. He built Lake Louise. He built what they began to talk about at Rema in 1980. And the ministers began to talk about the wagon wheel. Well, I knew where the wagon wheel was. R.G. Letourneau built that. I think they've closed it in a bit now. But there's a dome, and then there are wings out from it like spokes on a wagon wheel. What does that represent, Bobbie Jean? The wheel and the wheel of Ezekiel chapter 1, right? But this man, R.G. Letourneau, there's a spirit of poverty that has overtaken Tagore, Georgia. And God told me that in 1978. Well, small-minded will cause that. Small-minded will cause that, you see? And so, but R.G. Letourneau, that's a well that needs to be dug and could be dug in along that line. You don't have to be small-minded if you're going to be like R.G. Letourneau. And he was like Jesus, you see. And you know what? I've read his book, and he said that he worked for Caterpillar, and he was just, nothing was happening. He invented something about that big old wheel for Caterpillar, and they wouldn't accept it. So he left them and went on his own. And he was just being failure after failure. And he went to the Lord and said, what is it, God? I love you, da-da-da-da-da. God says, you're not tithing. Come on now. And there became something, 10%. You can argue until the days and the cows come home, right? But it makes a difference if we give 10% of our gross income. Come on now. And God says in the Old Testament, he says that if you don't give 10%, you're going to have to pay 20. How are you going to pay 20? Your car is going to break down. Your clothing is going to be cheap and worn out. Come on, can you shout at me? Just all kinds of things. Your house, your washing machine, whatever. And so you're paying somebody 20% of your income when God would let you and be honored to receive 10%. Now, I'm not looking at anybody because I don't know what anybody gives in the place. It doesn't matter, but I know it works. I'm a giver. Can you shout amen? Hallelujah. Let's give God the glory and say, I'm a giver. Hallelujah. That's a Pentecostal praise. Hallelujah. I stopped doing it. Somebody recently said, I haven't seen you do the Pentecostal praise in a long time. So you brought it back on. Hallelujah. But you see, that's a well that needs to be dug. What has been in our area, it's been, and we have closed the well up. You remember when Isaac had to go through the land and dig the wells that Abraham had dug in the beginning? We've got to do that. Hallelujah. But he gave 90% of his income, and he lived on 10, and he couldn't outgive God. That's, I have found you cannot outgive God. Can you shout amen? We have the strongest man in the world from Tagore, Georgia. Strength, not small-minded, not small soul, but I can do all things through Christ who constantly strengthens me. Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. Amen. And Paul Anderson, 1956, in Russia, Ukraine won against the strongest man in the world there. And no one has been able to break his title of the strongest man in the world. Well, people, I tell you, I asked God. I was at Rima, and everybody that came up to me and wanted to pray for me said, oh, Lord, give her strength. Give her strength. That still goes on today. I said, Lord, one time in Rima, I said, I must be the weakest person in the world. You send in all these people, and they're praying for my strength. But I'll tell you one thing. I am strong. Can you shout amen? That's a well that needs to be dug. People are small-minded, small soul. Get up. Give up. Quit, stop, don't do it. Your physical body is a lie of the devil. If you are listening to it, tell that body, I am healed. I am the body of Christ, and I have no sickness. I have no disease. I have no infirmity. I am not this. Woo! Be a imitator of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you shout amen? Amen. Woo! Glory, glory, glory. Can you shout amen? And give our God thanksgiving, saints. Hallelujah. Let's go. Let's go and give God the glory. Let's receive that strength. Hallelujah. Praise be unto God. I'm not going any further. But there is many wells to be dug. Amen. And we are going to be lion-hearted, which is the opposite of faint-hearted. We're not going to faint. Amen. Can you shout amen? Amen? You know what? When I was teaching on intercessory prayer in 1980, I have and all these, but that was the year, 1980, everywhere I went. And I found a verse. Isaiah 44:12 is one. And then it's in the Psalms. Oh, they fainted because they were hungry and thirsty. Thirsty. Where does thirst come from? You're not drinking. Is that right? And when I saw that, and then the other one, hungry, what do you do when you're hungry? You eat. Right? And I like to eat ice cream. Can you? You eat, right? And the Lord ministered to me, and I've ministered it everywhere that He wanted me to. If you're hungry, honey, eat the Word of God. That's the meat. Do the will of God. That's the meat. That'll satisfy your hunger. Come on. And then if you're thirsty, what do? You drink. And the Lord says, yeah, there's some, what's in it? Camp of people. That it was just word, 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 word. And He said they're choking on the word. Why? Because they're not drinking of the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost and the Word cannot be separated. They are to be together. They are a balancer. Balance yourself by praying in the Holy Ghost and eating the Word. Amen? It is a truth. It is a fact. Faint-hearted. Lion-hearted. Say, I'm lion-hearted. We're going to be. And it means despondent. 1 Thessalonians 5:14 and Proverbs 18:14. Maybe we'll read it tonight. Despondent. Despondent. You know, our faces show everything, right? And we can cover them up, right? Or we don't in our society. If you're despondent, you're faint-hearted. You don't have to be faint-hearted. Don't have to be. You wouldn't want to walk where I've walked. You can't tell me this or that. You can't tell me it's because of this and that. I've been to some rough, rough places in my life. But you know what? I didn't faint. I didn't get weaker. I got stronger. I didn't get bitter. I got better. Amen. Circumstances are not our God. Right? So we don't let them affect us. Right? Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So if I'm going to be a lion-hearted person, I'm going to have to see that. And I'm going to have to live that. Amen. Hallelujah. Despondent. Okay, let me look on. Faint. Wilson's Old Testament said, sad, sick of mind. Sad, sick of mind. Oh, goodness. Sad is the opposite of what? Glad. Just that simple. Sad is the opposite of glad. Well, I choose to be glad and refuse to be sad. Does it ever hit me to be sad? Oh, yeah. Come on now. But what do? I know the power of the secret place. I run and I get alone with my God until I get through with it. And if BJ needs to repent of any attitude or anything that I have done or thought, come on now, then I do that. Come on. And get it right. Amen. Write this down. Hebrews 9:14. It has, it's helped me ever since it was revealed to me. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ covers my mind, my conscience, my subconscious from every devil. Now, the opposite of evil is live, L-I-V-E. So you just take your choice. Am I going to put up with evil, or am I going to live? Amen? So you don't live. Heard this morning on that thing that was playing, the CD, the Word of God. Sin, when it's conceived and fully, is death. There's a way that seemeth right, but it leads to destruction. And we, you know, we have honored the devil too much. We have made him a little god, and he is not. He is helpless. He is hopeless. Come on. And we're going to be shocked when we get to heaven and find out that such a little something caused so much trouble. I liked what Lori's Lori's stepfather, Andrew's step-grandfather, said. The devil hadn't changed. You hear people say, oh, these are the days. They're just getting worse and worse and worse. The devil is just da-da-da. He knows his time is up. And it's, no, it's not. He's been the same since Genesis 1. Can you shout amen on this earth? Devil hadn't changed. Then I looked at death at past because it was a shock to me. I've been a pastor of Church of God's, you know, whatever. It's about 85, something like that. And I looked at him thinking, well, now if the devil hadn't changed, what's happened? You know? And so I didn't say a word. And he looked at me. He said, people have changed. People are letting him get away. That's, I've got that written down in the other book, that my notes. God says, my people are letting the devil get away with too much. We are lion-hearted. Whew, it's going to be good tonight if I don't get to it today. Is that all right? Hallelujah. I am telling you that devil is defeated. But we have got to know that. Can you shout amen? And we've got to begin to worship our holy God. Come on now. Since, oh boy, that's the one that just about put me on my face. I just broke and wept when Vanessa and them began to sing and play that holy, holy, holy song. Our God is holy, saints. And we have taken him too much as a bellhop. And we have forgotten how awesome that God is. And that he can hold in the palm of his hand all the waters of this earth. I mean, this is a mighty God we serve. Amen? Hallelujah. Now we have a one-on-one, heart-to-heart talk basis with him. But that requires some maturity. That requires some relationship. That requires some communication. Amen? Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lamb. But let me see what else that W.E. Vines. Oh, this is Vines. No, Vines have already given you. This is Wilson's. Sad. If you're sad, baby, choose glad. Amen. Amen. And it also means sick of mind, and it means wearied out. If we are wearied out, we are just doing something that God is not calling us to do. So the best way to do is to stop it. Amen? Amen. Get on the right track if we're weary. He said, don't be weary. Come unto me. Remember Matthew 11, 28 through 30? Don't get weary. That's silence in here. Amen? Oh, I'm just weary. I'm just worn out. Well, don't let yourself get weary. Hallelujah, saints. Glory to God. It means spent with labor. Do you know it's your mind? It's not your flesh. If it was your flesh, you could take a body. You could sleep for 8 hours and get over it. But if it's your mind, baby, your emotions, your small soul, if you can sleep 13 hours, and when you get up, you're still worn out. You're still tired. You're still weary. Come on now. And we are spirit, and we are soul, and we are body. And then, you know, as you grow, you find used to, it was, I just can't answer this telephone one more time. Okay? Now is, I just got to shut this text messaging off. And call a halt to it, or it'll weary you. There's a time for all things. And David, I don't know if he was wise or stupid or what. I don't mean to be dishonorable, but he won't even text. You don't know how many times you've missed some good from me because you didn't text. He's probably a wise man, isn't it? Like I am on the computers. Well, we'll move right along. I think I've gotten out of the anointing. Oh, what is that?
That's teenagers today.
Oh, I'm telling you, they do. Oh, boy, yes, they do. They do. And some people, you know, along the way have said when something happened and I texted or something, oh, you text? Like you're supposed to stop doing that at a certain age. I don't know. But then it means to fail in strength. When you're faint-hearted, you're failing in strength. And that goes back to what the Lord told me in 1980. And I began to tell the people, if you don't eat the word and you don't drink the Holy Spirit, you're going to faint. And God says, Paul Anderson, he gave this illustration, strongest man in the world. But if he doesn't drink and he all of that strength then faints, what good is that strength? So we've got to balance, you see. That's the word of God. Balance, balance, balance. And it means failing strength. And it means to be faint from want or lack of refreshment. Did you just hear? You got to refresh yourself. You know, we need refreshing every day, right? We need relationships that we know refresh us. You know, my mama had a favorite word, and she said, well, just hung around the fire too long. Do you remember Peter? He was around the fire, and he denied Jesus. And mother's idiom of that was that if you hang around the fire, if you carry on a conversation too long beyond the point that you should, you're going to end up saying something that you shouldn't have said. Good one, isn't it? So it's time we learn these things and leave the fire. Leave the relationship. Cut the conversation off. Amen? Yes. Hallelujah. That's a sign of maturity. Amen? I'm not talking about age. I'm talking about maturity in the Holy Spirit. Right? And it inevitably, I've lived it. I know it's the truth. If you stay around too long, you're going to say something that later you're going to regret saying. Yeah. Hallelujah. Am I getting across anything to us? Okay. What time do you close, Apostle? No, don't tell me that. You know, I'm a missionary. Okay, well, we'll see how far we can go. Okay? All right. Y'all still getting in something? Okay. All right. Then it means overwhelmed. You know, I've been overwhelmed. Have you ever been overwhelmed? Overwhelmed? Just confusion? Just overwhelmed. What meaneth this, Lord? I have. And it means to stop or to move. Amen? And the Lord is saying, hang around me and get that time of refreshing. Now, let's go back and read that one. In fact, I may go back and read the others now. But Acts chapter 3 and verse 19, repent, therefore, and be converted that your sins may be blotted out. When the times of refreshing shall come from one source. It does not come from a movie, a DVD, a book, or some person. Come on. This comes from the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. A refreshing comes from one source, and that is the presence of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And then let's go back and now read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 14. Let's just read that, please. Wait a minute. 2 Thessalonians, isn't it? Wait a minute. Let me see what it says. No. I must have missed it altogether. Anyway, no wonder you don't find things in Timothy that should be in Thessalonians. Oh, God. I'm just so excited. I thought I was coming out of myself just putting all of this again together last night and yesterday. Now, 1 Thessalonians 5:14 says, "Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, and be patient toward all men." So that's a part we play, right? That's something that we should have, that sincere, mature motive within us. And Proverbs 18:19. Ooh, Proverbs 18:19. Okay. Hallelujah. A brother offended, Proverbs 18:14. I am drunk again. Hallelujah. The spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity, but a wounded spirit who can bear? That's so easy to remedy. Jesus said in Luke 4:18, "I have come to bind up the brokenhearted." I'd have to read that to get it just exactly right. Here we go. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, those who need it, those who want it, those who know they need it. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those that are wounded, bruised, brokenhearted." Wounded spirit. He stopped on that one. Okay, he's just saying to me, wounded spirit, there's one way to get that remedied. Forgive. Forgive the offender with your mouth open, speaking those words. Every time, if it doesn't go away then, if the devil tries to put it back in your mind, forgive him again. Come on. Put it under the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Years ago, when I first found out the power of the tongue, the power of our words, I said, "Lord, who then of us can make it? What are we going to do?" And he said, "The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ is the only thing that will annihilate a word that you've spoken that you do not want to have come to pass." So if you know that you've spoken something and you don't want that to come to pass, put that word, "I repent, Lord, and I plead the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ over that word." And another way, "I bless that person." Amen. "I bless them and I pray for them." We got to walk out. I see a tunnel that has been black, you know, like a railroad track under those tunnels. And then there's the light at that end where it's going through. And I see, saints, there's light for us. And we are going to walk in that light and not in that darkness. Amen. This is the day to make that turn around. Okay? Because I could start a new thing tonight. 12. Okay. We've got to do a few other things, though. And we'll just dismiss at 12, right? How about everybody praying in the spirit now? Would you do that with me? Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. Okay, I got it now to end it, you know, to go on. I want you to turn to Deuteronomy chapter 20 with me. Deuteronomy chapter 20. And hallelujah. I didn't have that written down for some. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do. Okay. But it's way down there. Okay. The topic heading over this scripture is how to wage war. Okay. Let me give you this. This is the IDF. Who knows what the IDF is? Andrew. It's the Israeli Defense Force. He would have known. Amen. So this is what their army and war strategies are right here in a nutshell. I'm just giving you a nutshell. Number one, every warrior, say as a lion, I am a warrior. Say it.
As a lion, I am a warrior.
Once again.
As a lion, I am a warrior.
And once again.
As a lion, I am a warrior.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. All right. Then this is a good war strategy for you. Number one, if you're a warrior, they are, those Israeli soldiers, they have a code of life. Now, what does that code of life mean, colon? It is a list of values higher than oneself. Yes. You know, I love horse movies. And I've got my little top shelf on that group shelves of little horse DVDs. Higher than oneself. And I just watched a movie of a girl, maybe 12 years old, I think she was, and she loved horses. She rode, and her dad was riding in some kind of event, and her daddy, in feeling of her, for some reason, he found out she had a fever. You've read that? Seen that? And said, I don't think you should ride because this fever. And she insisted she was okay, that it was the last event of this group of events, whatever, maybe a trophy thing. And she had to ride. And she was all right, she kept saying. She rode, but she hadn't gone hardly any distance. And she fell off of that horse. And it paralyzed her. They thought her whole body was paralyzed at first, but it was just like from the waist down, paralyzed. And so he hired some lady to come in for therapeutic live-in to help her and get her to a place, because she wouldn't do anything but looking down. She would not look, she would not speak, she would not eat. It was terrible. And he was doing everything. Listen to this, parents. He was doing everything for her. But when this hard person came in who knew how to get somebody out of that he had hired, and she said, I'll come under some conditions. This is one. I am the one that's helping her, whatever she used. It's not you. In other words, you won't interfere when it gets rough, okay, and tough, okay. And so she came in, and sometime in the movie, at a point in time, her daddy was really upset with that woman because through her knowledge, she knew couldn't do everything for this daughter. That if this daughter was going to live a normal life, she had to begin to do things for herself. And then she made this statement. The one thing that will set her on the right track is when she values somebody else more than she values herself. To me, and I wouldn't watch those things if I didn't get a principle. But the principle was, when I value God more than my own self or anybody else, then it's going to work right. Life is going to be the result. Well, finally, this horse that the owner didn't think anybody was going to be able to ride. They called him rebellious and every other kind of word, you know. But that horse and that girl bonded. And she was forced to feed the horses by that woman. And so, anyway, she began to love that horse more than herself. And to tell you the truth of the matter, ended up because she loved him more than she valued herself. And in a moment of protecting and so forth, him and da-da-da-da-da, whatever, she began on the road up, come on, to live a normal life. The only way we're going to live the normal life of a Christian is to value our God more than we value ourselves. Amen. Does that bless you? Yeah. Thank you. When thou goest out to battle against thine enemies, and seest horses and chariots and a people more than thou, be not afraid of them, for the Lord thy God is with thee, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And it shall be, when you are come nigh unto the battle, that the priest shall approach and speak unto the people, and shall say unto them, Hear, O Israel, you approach this day unto battle against your enemies. Let not your hearts faint. Fear not, and do not tremble, neither be ye terrified because of them. The Hebrew meaning of faint there is to be terrified. And another meaning in the Hebrew is make haste. How many of you have made haste? How many of them your grandmamas ever told you, haste makes waste? This morning I was trying to haste. And something, you know, I couldn't get this pen right. Because I was trying to haste and get the pen right at the same time. Come on. And finally, I just took a deep breath, stood back, and said, haste means waste. I will not be in haste to get this pen on right. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lamb. You know what happened? Holy Ghost, help me. Came out of my mouth. Holy Ghost, help me pen this pen. I asked the Holy Ghost to help me with everything. Because I can't do anything without him. You know, the next pen in, got it right. Hallelujah. Can you shout amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Haste makes waste. Have you ever said something before you should? Have you ever done something before you should? Ooh, Jesus. Tremble means make haste. No, yes, tremble. If we shake and tremble at something, we're making haste. Now look, don't you be terrified. Why don't we don't need to be afraid or be concerned about the future? We don't need to be listening to all these reports. Yesterday, I got text after text after text. I think it was yesterday, telling me that President Obama and the president of China and the president of Iran and the Pope and somebody else were meeting, and I just got da-da-da-da-da. I said, Lord, I got a drawback from this. And I did not read another text. You know, you can see on your phone what they're going to text about. I just didn't read them. Can you shout amen? There's a time, sweet people. There's time and a season for all things. Hallelujah. Some people, and the ones that were texting me said, we're watching this. Thank God my TV is downstairs. And the only time I'm downstairs, wonderful, wonderful downstairs, is when I build a fire in that fireplace when it gets cold. Can you shout? If it keeps on, I'm going to have to go downstairs. So I've got my DVD player upstairs and VHS and my TV I can turn on, but I don't want to turn it on if it's like that. Can you shout amen? Belly up. Come on. I do not want that Fox News to be my God. Can you shout amen? And I certainly don't want CNN to be my God. Better than your shout. Hallelujah. Okay, let's see. We're going to read it, and then we're going to close this. Hallelujah. Ute shata. God's going to heal a shoulder this morning. He's already started, and I don't know who it is, but you're healed in Jesus' name. For the Lord your God is he that goeth with you to fight for you against your enemies. You get it? God is fighting for you against the enemies to save you. We concluded in May. Andrew is a spiritual warrior. His tongues, the devil hates his tongues. He's a spiritual warrior. His brother has that AK-16 in his hand. Don't mess with him. Hallelujah. He can outshoot the FBI and the GBI. Come on. And the A, what is that? Something ADF, alcohol, tobacco, drugs, and firearms. Come on now. He's a marksman. He's a warrior. I got so tickled because Laura's wanting a picture of Andrew with his praying hands when he was a little bitty fella, baby, came out that way. So I've been looking through some pictures. And we know this spiritual warrior right here. Boy, I tell you, if you want the glory to come down, just spend some time in prayer with him. And the glory's going to come down. Ooh, glory to God. Ooh, I'm getting over here. I'm going to fall. Amen. So that's settled. But in looking through these pictures, Lori, I'm at my desk, and Jonathan must have been about 12 years old. He was one that always wore whatever he was playing. If it was Indians, he had on his Indian outfit. If he was a policeman, he had on his guns and all of that stuff. So he's now in the military, you know, as well as, but anyway. And so here I find myself sitting at the desk in this picture in my office. Jonathan is standing behind me, dressed in an army outfit, and he has a gun. And I said, thank you, Lord, I'm covered in the spirit and I'm covered in the natural. Can you shout amen? Woo, I'm having fun with you guys this morning. Can you shout amen? This is fun. Praise the Lord. Can we read some more? I'm going to finish, Brother David, and I am going to pray for people tonight. I was thinking that I would do it this morning, but I'm not going to do it tonight. And the officers shall speak unto the people and say, now, okay, these are the people that can't go. What man is there that hath built a new house and hath not dedicated it? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle and another man dedicate. It's pretty heavy, isn't it? And what man is he that hath planted a vineyard and hath not eaten of it? Let him also go and return unto his house, lest he die in the battle and another man eat of it. Number three. And what man is there that hath betrothed a wife and hath not taken her? Let him go and return unto his house, lest he die in the battle and another man take her. These are kind of funny to me. Y'all figure it out yourselves, okay? And the officers shall speak further unto the people and shall say, what man is there that feareth, that is fearful and faint-hearted? Let him go and return unto his house, lest his brethren's heart faint as well as his heart. I'm not reading any further. Don't be around faint-hearted people. If they're fainting, you may faint too. Birds of a feather flock together. Well, stop it. Just don't join that flock of birds. Amen? Hallelujah. If you don't want to faint, then don't be with people who faint. And what is faint-hearted? We've already said enough about it. We haven't covered it all. And we're not going to cover it all. Amen? Because the Bible's full of it. Faint-hearted person is a fearful person. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of boldness. Come on, y'all. Spirit of power and love and a sound mind. Well, a faint-hearted person is small-minded, so that's not sound. You know, just put these scriptures together. They teach themselves. Amen? Hallelujah, saints. It's time to come to the bar. Raise our standard. Come on. Believe in ourselves. I don't think I ever said it, so let me say it now. When I was traveling all over this world, the one thing that I saw was that America is eaten up with rejection. People allowing a spirit of rejection to tell them they don't amount to a hill of beans. That's not what God says in the Bible. Why are you grinning? Is that funny to you? No, I'm telling you, saints, we got to start acting like who we are. We got to be that lion. We got to be in Christ. Come on. Got to be bold in him. Oh, we learn when to speak and when not speak. Come on. If you don't, you'll learn it, because God will jerk you up a few times and you will learn it. Amen. You'll fall on your face. And what do they say? You know, a pie in your face or something like that. You won't, you'll grow. You don't have to worry about it. But there comes a time when, you know, it's blessed. I found a picture of, yesterday was Friday, I guess, and I gave it to Lisa to put, because people want you to put pictures on the Facebook, you know. So anyway, I gave her this picture. I found this picture of mother and myself side by side. And so I gave it to Lisa, and I said, now put this under it. Mama Sarah and Mama Jean, because people are beginning to call me Mama. Hallelujah. Can you shout amen? And I love it. So I praise God for it. So if you want to know who I am, forget the titles. I'm Mama Jean. And mamas are like grandmamas. They have a right to speak into your life. Amen. I love it. I'm just having the best time, David. Do you know that I was presented the Doctor of Divinity degree in July? What? Grace Institute of Biblical Studies. Why you made it a Doctor of Divinity, Bobbie Jean? The books I've written, the miles I've gone, the people I've ministered to, all of that is behind me. Can you shout him in? So who are you? Well, president, founder of A Great Love, apostle, prophet, teacher. Let me see now. I had about seven or eight. Oh, sister. So glad you didn't call me Sister Merck this morning. Hallelujah. I say I'm so glad you did not call me Sister Merck. No. I'm sister to some people, especially those that have come out of Pentecost. Amen. I'm mama. That's it. Mama, sister. In other words, I'm just having a blast. And I'm going to go home and eat my leftovers from yesterday. And eat my ice cream, and I'm going to come back tonight, and we're going to have a blast.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Well, there were so many principles, so many truths that came out this morning. I hope you were listening. You know, I've said this a long, long time, and some have heard it. Most have not, but you're never going to get where you're going hanging out with people that's not going there. And it's been proven time and time again. And I'll be honest with you, I can tell where a person is going in life by who their friends are, who their acquaintances are, who they honor. Who do they consider to be an honorable person? I can tell you, don't even have to be a prophet. All you got to do is watch. So we need to be careful about our relationships, don't we? Amen. Praise God. Won't you go ahead and stand? We'll have a word of prayer. Sister Bob Jean, that was so good. So good. Yes, I do. We got 10 minutes. Y'all ready to give?